We have four. We might as well start. We have 37, 38. Okay, guys. This is Upmanu Lal at Columbia University, and we are trying to get things started. We did a little bit because we know people are sometimes slow to join. We appreciate all of you joining. This is part of our series on America's water, past, present, and future. And our project is funded by the National Science Foundation as part of their Water Sustainability and Climate Program. And we are looking at how best water can be used in the United States in an economic sense. One of the stimuli for this project was EPA report, which basically said that the EPA has no idea how to value, come up with the economic value of water because it's intersects with so many different things and there's not clarity on how to do this. So what we are trying to develop is a knowledge base on how these things work, and this webinar series is part of that. Today's webinar in particular goes exactly in the direction that we would like to understand more. It's by Professor David from the University of California. He's one of the very few people who's been doing amazing work at the intersection of water, agriculture, and economics. He's an economist. And as far back as the 80s, he had very interesting paper he had published on irrigation technology and what is the choice of different technologies. And more broadly, he's looked quite a bit at issues related to efficiency and technology choice and innovation in both water and agriculture. We asked everyone who's participating in this series to present a perspective which would be at a national scale in terms of setting or understanding issues related to policy or physical constraints or other aspects. And so in that context, I think the topic that he's talking about today, which is water rights and water markets, is the most important one in terms of shaping future behavior of users with respect to water. So with that introduction, and actually if you go to Professor Zilberman's website, you'll see a very eclectic and amazing set of things that he works on. Let me hand it over to David and let's get the seminar started.
Okay. Good morning. It's a big pleasure to be to this seminar. And what I'll try to do is to speak about the economics of water and argue that in order to understand water, you have to understand biology, economics, and politics. So if you look at water, what really matters in water, especially in not only in the United States, but especially in the United States, is the water institution. And one of the big challenges of water is that we really don't have a lot of market forces, and we don't have market forces that characterize behavior in the agro field. So if I look at the presentation, I'll give a little bit of the background about water economics, water policy, and some of the big issues, and then I'll speak about economic-based approach to water policy reform, how you design water projects, how you allocate water, how you price water, and some of the big challenges of water management. Now, as you can see in this discussion, in many cases, what I am doing, I am presenting economic ideas, but economic ideas are really related to things that are happening on the ground. So now let's look and see about what are the dimensions of water, especially when it comes to irrigation. We have two types of sources, surface versus groundwater. Surface water are lakes, rivers. These are waters that are accumulated and you have to divert them by canals. Groundwater are water that you pump. Now, so this is a, and these two sources of water get totally different treatment. And you'll see later when I speak about some of the problems of the Western United States, of the, you can see that surface water and ground not the same. They are different, they have different price, different choices, different challenges. The other thing is, what are the decisions that people have to make about water? They have to decide about extension of supply by building canal, by digging wells, by managing demand, by pricing, introducing new technologies, and by quality control. And that is another very important, because when it comes to water, water quality matters. And I don't speak about, obviously, water quality for human consumption, but even when it comes to irrigation or industrial use, different levels of quality, different constituents of water within water in terms of chemicals make a big difference. The other thing that is very important is allocate water. How do you allocate water? Through system of water rights, where people are queued, or system of water market where they buy. The last thing is a very important distinction between two different types of utilization of water, consumptive use and non-consumptive use. Consumptive use are activities that actually consume the water, irrigation, drinking, industrial use. Non-consumptive use are recreation, hydroelectric power to some extent.
Sorry, David, your slides are not moving. I don't know if you can move them, or if you want to say next, and I'll move the slides.
No, I'm okay. I can move them, no problem.
Okay, you're on slide 3, right?
I'm on slide C, yes. I move them. In a second, I move to slide B. Okay? It's okay? I continue. To continue? Yes. So, okay. Now I move to another issue about water, which is the issue that I call heterogeneity and conflict. You cannot speak about water in uniform terms. Now, some countries like Canada have a lot of water. Others like Jordan don't have a lot of water. But even in Canada, they have desert. And heterogeneity is very important. If you ask me as economist, what the main feature that allows activities is heterogeneity, because it provides opportunities for trade. And it also implies that there are different interests among different individuals. So you can have on some areas drought prevention and some areas flood control, and it may be at the same place. Many years ago, I was invited to Israel to discuss how to deal with the drought there. It was in February. While I was there, they had incredible rain, and suddenly the topic moved from drought to flood. So to some extent, a key element of water is variability. And the other thing that is very important about water is that water you have conflict. You know the saying of Mark Twain, that whiskey is for drinking, water is for fighting. Generally speaking, in many parts of the world, there are water scarcity. There is a big conflict with agriculture, urban, industrial, and the environment. Generally speaking, as a rule, whenever you have irrigation, it may consume between 70 to 80% of the water that are not environmental water. But are you allocate water between the environment and the human consumption? Are you allocate water between agriculture and the urban sector? This is quite not clear. In some parts of the world, for example, in India, it's clear that we over-irrigate. In other parts of the world, like Africa, we under-irrigate. This heterogeneity is very important, and in different locations, you have different problems and different solutions. Now, the other thing that is important is the value of water varies across location. For example, if you look at California, strawberries, flowers, and even marijuana can yield $1,000 per acre foot. Cotton cannot pay more than $100 per acre foot, pastoral $30. So to some extent, the price of water and the value of water vary. It's very difficult when someone asks me, what's the price of water in California, India, or whatever? There is no one price. It depends where. It depends for what use, when, and at what quality. Now, generally speaking, there is big, large differences in the value of water in agriculture. Generally speaking, 20 to 30% of the water generates maybe 70 or 80% of the value. This is very important. So if you have a drought, you can reduce a lot of the amount that you use for irrigation, but still keep a lot of the value if you allocate your water efficiently. Now, the other thing is the issue of a crisis. There is now, we now consume about 8 times more than you consumed in 1950. Now, most of the water use resources in the world are known. The only area we really underutilize water is Africa. But and in many places, people feel that we have a crisis. But in most cases, it's not a crisis of not available water, but of water management. There's a water management crisis and not water availability crisis. And when we look at sustainability, namely, reaching a situation that we are able to grow while we maintain environmental quality, the key challenge is management of the right institutions, and in water we have a long way to go. Now, so basically what I really will speak about water, the first thing is that there are several causes to the institutions that we have, and what we need in water today, we need transitions from existing institution to new institution. And economic is very important in design of this transition, and politics are as important as well. So what is a key element of transition? When I speak about transition, what do I mean by transition? Transition means that you move, let's say, from a system that you allocate water by water right and you introduce market, that you design a water project, that you design a system that people that contaminate water pays a penalty. This type of an institutional transition requires a lot of physical changes, but also a lot of political and distributional changes. You have losers and gainers, and we have to understand it before we design this type of transition. Now, generally speaking, and I think to understand water, I think what you really need to understand is a little bit of a theory that is called induced innovation and induced institution. Several factors determine what type of arrangement we have. Water scarcity, the strength of the government, policy objective, and adoration. This is a very important slide. So, because what I argue, the different set of situations will result in different set of institutions. Why it's important? Because if I look at history, you'll see that you'll have different set of institutions that result in different outcomes. So if you look at the 19th century or 18th century in America or India or other countries, there was a lot of water, government was really weak, there was a desire for economic growth. People want, the government wanted that people will develop water, but they didn't really add the money to help that. So they told them, okay, if you develop the water, you have the right for water forever. And that resulted in water rights, and I'll speak a little bit about it in detail, that people that have historical right to utilize their water. Now, in a later period, beginning of the 20th century in the U.S. and then in the rest of the world, suddenly you still have a lot of water, but now you have government has a lot of money, and again, they desire to grow, so what they do, the government designed to be the same water. So in the 19th century, the government gave people water rights. In the 20th century, the government built water projects. Now, if water becomes more scarce, you realize that this water right may not utilize resources efficiently, and I explain it later on. So you need to have water trading. Now, later on, you realize that the government doesn't have water to manage, money to manage a water system. For example, the government doesn't have enough money to manage urban water. So what you do, you privatize water supply. And finally, when you start being concerned about environmental regulation, you start having water quality regulation, and you start having payment for ecosystem services. So different conditions have different institutions. So I repeat, so if you have water abundance, like in the 19th century, weak government, desire to grow, then you have water rights. And that's what happened all over the world. And it's very similar to what happened in land. The government established basically land grants and the homesteading because they wanted people to settle the land. Later on, when the government has money, they develop public projects like the Central Valley Project, the Arizona Water Project, many water projects in developing countries. In China, they develop big water projects. Now, later on, you start having an environment scarcity, and you have water trading, financial crisis, and you have privatization, and then an environmental concern, and you have environmental regulation. Now, the big challenge in water policy is transition from one system to another. To introduce trading, to introduce environmental quality regulation, to change water project design. This is a big challenge, a big political challenge. Water trading generally introduced after drought. Environmental quality regulation was a result in the U.S. of the Clear Water Act after many years of pressure by the environmental movement. Change in water quality design was a result of a lot of public pressure. Now, there are many, many changes of transition. Population growth leads to scarcity, and then you start to sink your water. Changing attitude about the environment matter. Changes in government finances. The government is able to tax people. The government in the U.S. became rich after the income tax. And then if you have new institutions like the World Bank that are ready to loan to people to develop water projects. Now, transitions are not alike. They vary. The reforms occur in different places. The reason that I emphasize it, because if you are a water professional, you write all this paper, no one cares about it, boom, one day they realize that they need to make change and they rely on your papers. So, for example, transition to water trading may take many years. I spent 30 years of my life on writing about water reform, and then it took in 1992. So generally, water quality, a water crisis triggers transition. And a lot of time, small crisis may lead to a big change. The way we design project in dams in California changed after a big accident in 1922 that flooded the San Fernando Valley. Long period of drought lead to migration and to storage. This is a story from the Bible. So transitions are costly. They require a lot of background, a lot of research, and they require political savvy and institution. If the transition is good, you're successful. If it's bad, then you can really destroy your society. So what I like to do is to speak about economic-based approach to water management and reform so you can understand what you need in transition. And I speak about four main elements: water projects, water pricing, kitchen choices, and recycling. First, water projects. Water projects are dams, canals, other type of arrangement that people move water from A to B. For example, the Roman aqueduct, the Hoover Dam. These are big, big projects. In the United States, we have a organization, Army Corps of Engineering, and the Bureau of Reclamation, the design water projects. Now, historically, water projects were a result of political decisions. There was no formal assessment. It was a political decision. And then in the United States, in 1970s, people introduced a formal benefit-cost analysis before water projects. You look at the benefit, you look at the cost, and if the expected benefit are greater than the cost, then it makes economic sense to have the project. Now, the World Bank is taking the same approach, and most of the technical benefit-cost analysis is a result of water of the need to evaluate water projects. In China, it is being done, but it's not that important. For example, the big project in China that moved water from the southeast to the northwest was done because Mao Zedong once said, there is water in the south, there is no in the north, something has to be done. Obviously, people did some benefit-cost analysis, but there was strong ideology behind it. But in the United States and in the rest of the world, you start to look, does it make economic sense? Now, how you do benefit-cost analysis? I don't have time to teach it, but it's expected future benefit discounted minus expected future cost discounted. But the question is, what benefit and cost are important? How do you design the project? And here I leave you with two points that are very important. First, when you look at the project, a project is not only a physical project, it has to have not only structure, but also institution. What do I mean? You can build a big water project with canals, and you basically say that everyone will get as much water as they need. Or you build a big a smaller water project, and you say, we will develop a system of bidding, and people will have to pay the marginal cost of the water or some sort of, some cost of water, of cost of operation of the project, and we will have trading among people. So someone, some year someone will buy more, and some year someone will buy less. If you design a water institution that increases efficiency at the farm level, you will have more output and less and smaller projects. So designing of water institutions is very, very important. You can, from the beginning, design a project that basically says everyone can get water, or you design from the beginning a system that says about system of priority, or a system that decides we develop storage inside the project. So if there is too much water, we have groundwater storage that are part of the project. So water project design is not about how you use complete, but how you use incentives. That is very, very important. Again, I can give a course on how you design water project, but you really need to remember, water projects are not only concrete, they are not engineering, they are also economic and engineering and management and biology. The other thing is, when you look at the benefit on cost, you don't only look at the market benefit, you look at the non-market benefit. Again, this is a call, this is a long topic that I and others teach in the classes. But generally speaking, you don't have markets for tomatoes, onion, lettuce, automobiles. You also have economic value for pretty views, for endangered species, for sustaining ecosystems. And you can quantify it and you add it in your analysis. And there are many techniques to do it. But a key point is that you cannot have a symmetric approach to the environment. You cannot say, when I evaluate a project, I would only consider the environmental benefit and quantify it and not the environmental cost, or vice versa. You have to consider the environmental benefit and the environmental cost. In the United States, the Bureau of Reclamation didn't consider the environmental cost in the benefit-cost analysis, and that led to making many projects look very good because they seem to produce a lot of benefits through providing more water for fish, but they people ignore the environmental costs that are associated with moving water from location A to location B. Now, the key point of water system is optimal allocation or optimal pricing of water. People that use water have to pay the price of water, but the price varies by location, quality, use, and the institution. Now, generally, if I look at the private, if I look at a simple model and say, what are, how I determine how much water I use, I compare the benefit and the cost, but the cost has several elements. For example, if you look at groundwater that provide a system of canals, you have the extraction from a lake or from a aquifer, the conveyance. You may have externality costs, because if you take later water from a lake, you don't have enough water for fish. And then you also, if you use too much water, you may not have water in the future. So these four costs have to be taken into account. So if I, so you have this figure, you have on one hand demand, on the other hand you have several costs. This is the blue one is the marginal private cost. This is the marginal, the red one is the marginal private cost plus the marginal conveyance cost. The dark blue is the marginal private cost, conveyance cost, and externality cost. And the highest one is private, conveyance, externalities, and future cost. Optimal management of water will result in being in point A. A lot of time people ignore externality cost and future cost and are in B. Sometimes they ignore all the costs except for the private cost and they are in M. And in many cases, people subsidize water and they are in M. The big problem in water resource management is you're a lot of time in M instead of A. So you extract too much water, you over-irrigate, you use too much water because you don't take into account all the costs. And some of the water reform is to develop institutes that move you from NA, from N to A. So optimal water pricing has to take marginal extraction, conveyance, environmental, and storage costs. And that's very, very important. Now, if you have optimal pricing and you deal and you eliminate subsidies, suddenly a lot of things will happen. Farmers will adopt conservation technologies. A lot of low-value crop will be grown. There will be more environmental benefit. There will be less water project, because if people use less water, you don't need water project, and you less stable systems. So to some extent, raising the price of water to represent its social form is very desirable, but it has a lot of challenges. Okay, so now I move to a little bit more discussion of some of the detail of water institutions. Now, a lot of times, in most cases, government societies own the rights to water and give it to individuals. And the individuals can be, the rights may depend on where you are located, where you settle the land, when you start using the water, and you may have priority. For example, if you have in California the right to use water from the Sierra, are allocated according to historical precedent. So first, people that get the right have prior right. So generally speaking, if you have small amount of water, only people with senior right get the water. But sometimes government may also give people permits to use water that are like water rights, but they may not be based on historical base, but on some other base. In Florida, you don't have historical rights, you have instead water permits. But indeed, in all of these cases, the allocation is not by market, the allocation is by some sort of a priority. Now, there are several water rights systems. One is a riparian water rights system, where people that are along a river have a right to divert water for their own use but cannot sell it elsewhere. And you cannot allow, you cannot transfer water, and you cannot sell water, and you can't. And basically, the water will stay within the system. A prior appropriation system allowed people to move water away from the source, for example, from one region to another, but people have rights, and these are historical rights. So if you build, if there is a canal, the people that you got the water first have prior rights relative to others. And the other two elements in this system is use it or lose it, and first in use and first in queue. So if you don't use your water for a while, you lose your right. So if you have three people and the guy with the oldest right didn't use the water, he's out of the system, and number two and three get high priority. Now, as I mentioned before, instead of prior appropriation, you have water permits. Like in Florida, that people are allowed to use groundwater, to use water from a lake, and they apply to permit every year. In all of these systems, there is very limited trading within individuals. So one of the key elements that we see as economists is transition to trading. If you have a system that you cannot sell your water right, and if you don't use the right, you lose it, people wouldn't use water efficiently. They wouldn't conserve water. They will use all the water, otherwise they use the right. But trading would provide people an incentive. If you can sell the some of the rights, or if you can transfer some of your water to others and you make money, you may adopt conservation technology so you can get the same output with less water, and then someone else can use the water. Or a farmer can take some of the water, he can adopt a sprinkler and sell water to the city. So, to some extent, trading is a very important mechanism to improve water use efficiency. And so, to some extent, one key reform is to allow trade. Now, this is a graph that explains gains from trade. Not everyone can understand it, because you need to have a little bit of background in economics. This is demand. This is the initial demand when water system was established. So all the rights were exhausted, and the area under the low curve, this area under the low red curve represents the value of consumption of water using the initial allocation of water, which is a prior appropriation system. Now, so you basically, initially, this is the demand, and this demand is represent the initial settler. But over time, there are new settlers, and this is a new demand. This new demand is the upper line. The area between these two demands is extra social gain from water use. But you don't have trading, you don't move from the white area to this area above it. But if you have water market, then what happens is the people that have the international, the initial right, keep only part of the water, the first half, this amount, and new people get the rest of the water. The price of water is equal to this line. And there is a social gain that is the area above the demand, above this curve. Is it clear? This area, the pink and the gray, represent the gain from trade. So, if you didn't understand the graph, and many of you, I'm sure, didn't understand it, the basic idea is this. When there was a small initial user of water, they gained, let's say, from water use $1 million. Now, if there are more people that are interested in water, the value of the water may be $2 million. But So the initial value should sell the water that provide them low value to the new user that can get much higher value for the same amount of water. So basically what happened with trade, you conserve water or you stop using water to low value activity to give other people the opportunity to use water for high value activity. For example, when people started in California, they used water to grow wheat. Now, or to grow tomatoes. But then some people start building a city called Los Angeles. In an ideal world, the people that were growing tomatoes should have sold some of the right to the water to Los Angeles, adopt drip irrigation or sprinkler irrigation, so they get the same number of tomatoes with less water, and Los Angeles gets much more value from selling it to consumers. And the people that sold the water make money because they get, because the water are much more valuable to the Los Angeles people, and the Los Angeles people get value because they can have home under the sun rather than live in another place. Is it clear? So water trading is very, very important because it allows using more activities with existing amount of water. And there are a lot of examples of successful trading. One example is in Chile. In Chile, many of you probably know about Chile and why. The wine developers are decent users of water in Chile, but they were able to get the water because of trading. So trading is very useful in order to expand the demand of water. But in order to do it, you need to monitor, you need to expand canal system, you need to negotiate new agreements, you need to start to price water. So there are transition costs associated for moving from trading, from water right to water trading. Now, the volume of water may not be very big in any case, but may be very crucial to adjust to shortages. I'll give you an example. In California, we had a big short, drought. And when you have a big drought, water moves from people that grow rice that produce very, very low value to people that grow trees. And so tree owners not having water is a disaster because they lose the trees. So in rice, the value of acre feet is $50. In trees, it's $1,000. So you speak about $950 gain per acre foot. You multiply it by a million acre foot, you speak about $1 billion gain from trade. A billion acre foot is only 3% of the water in California. So sometimes even small trading generates huge value. Now, trading may have a lot of side effects. For example, what people call third-party effects. If I use water, I sell you the water that I used to apply on my field, and not all my water was used on my crop. Some of it was unintentionally penetrating the soil and moving to someone else. If I don't irrigate my field, they don't have their water. And this is what's called third-party effect. And a lot of time when water use efficiency is not that high, when a certain percentage of the water is going to the groundwater or to moving to other farms, water trading may affect third parties unintentionally. And therefore, a lot of time you have to think that you have to give some of the water before you have trade to the people that may be affected as third parties. Now, generally speaking, every time that you build a water product and move water from one place to another, there are trading. Every time that someone builds a new city that uses existing water, you need to have trading. Now, adaptation to climate change may require a lot of trading because you move water from locations that have water rights to locations that don't have water rights. So the locations that have water rights may not become as productive, but at least they will make money from selling the rice. So there are several types of arrangement of trading in agriculture or in water. One is transferable right. You basically rent your right to someone for 1 year, and you say, okay, I have a right for 10 million acre foot, I give you 5 million acre foot, so you go to the source, to the water, and to the water provider and get the water instead of me. And you can speak about transferable rights that are permanent or temporary for 1 year, only during a drought. And the other stuff is payment for ecosystem services. That people buy the right to water to protect environment and water quality. So basically, what happened is you buy the right, water right, to pay for ecosystem services. So the vets and the government a lot of time may establish programs that allow environmental agencies to buy water to save the fish. So as I speak before, markets would lead to conservation. What do I mean by conservation? Adopting irrigation technologies that have higher input use efficiency. I'll speak about it later on. And market can lead to conservation and only if the value of the water of saved is and the increase in yield is greater than conservation. Than the cost of conservation. Now, generally, the basis of water conservation is very simple. Generally speaking, we have to distinguish between applied water and effective water, the water that we apply and the water that we use. Water use efficiency is the ratio between effective and applied water, and modern irrigation technologies increase water use efficiency. Generally, when you adopt drip or sprinkler, they increase yield, to save water, but reduce drainage, and the gain is likely to occur on low-quality land, on hills, on steep hills, on sandy soil. So you don't need to adopt everywhere, only when the gain are greater than the cost of the technology. This is one main way to improve water. Another way to improve water use efficiency is by improved conveyance. When we have canals, much of the water is being lost. Sometimes if you have canals that are belt canals, you may lose 50 or 60% of the water. So a lot of the time you may need to improve the canals So conveyance efficiency will increase. But generally speaking, farmers on their own won't have the incentive to have good canals because if I'm upstream, I don't care about people downstream. So improved canal require good pricing and regional cooperation that the interest of everyone should be taken into account. Another activities that are very, very important when it comes to water systems are desalinization and water recycling. Desalinization is costly only if you have severe water scarcity and cheap energy. And when you do desalinization, you have to look at the greenhouse cost. Recycling of wastewater is more affordable because you have the water already, they are less salty, so water recycling has a huge potential in the future. So, and a last point is to manage water inventory. Water inventory is valuable because in droughts, water are more valuable than during periods of floods or during excess rain. So you really need to develop conjunctive use where the groundwater is absorbing some of the water when you have good years and you pump in dry years. And again, you need to have economic incentives to do it. So to some extent, if you have reform, you need to invest in storage, conveyance, recycling, desalinization, to have real pricing of water, to have a pollution prey principle, and to have incentive for adoption of modern irrigation technology. So it's reform first allows you to move to water market. secondly require bill pricing of groundwater. You need to pay for externalities, for side negative side effect of water. You need to incentivize adoption of waste technologies, and you need to invest in conversion, recycling, and desalinization. So if I summarize, reform requires raising the price of water, new institution, more efficiency, but it's challenging. It requires reliable institutions, facts, not guesses, good economy, good administration, legal understanding, political leadership, and skill and patience. Reform is challenging, but it is a key for water system, and you need to know economic and hydrology to design. Now, we have several examples of crisis, our crisis leading to change. In California, we have the drought in 1987-1991, and basically it led to large adoption of drip irrigation, basically reduction of low-value crop, and the amount of water that was available was replaced by conservation, groundwater, and taking lead out of production. And what really happened is that after the drought, people introduced water trading. But still, in California, we have a lot of political reasons, political obstacles. We don't have full trading. We have regulations that don't allow water recycling. We subsidize electricity, so there is too much groundwater pumping. We don't monitor aquifer, and we underinvest in conservation. Even in California, that is relatively advanced, water institutions are behind. So what happened in Tibet, in many developing countries? So generally, water systems tend to be paralyzed, and only crisis can change them. But we now have a lot of threats that we have to adopt. High energy costs, climate change, and some decay of existing system. So I may go to the conclusion. Water resource management reform is very important. It can improve economic and environmental benefits. Irrigation is very valuable. Swiss reform, you can increase water productivity through incentives. A key element is to increase trading, but you can also increase efficiency through incentivizing adoption of irrigation technologies, and as well as you can do it by introducing conjunctive use, etc. Second set of point is that crisis trigger changes. Higher energy crisis may increase demand for water and may increase demand for reform. And high energy crisis can provide opportunities to reduce subsidies and lead to water reform. Now, why do I say it? We are now in a period where we are concerned about climate change, we are concerned about energy prices, and I think in this period where we have higher energy cost, concern about climate change, concern about environmental degradation, this is a period to introduce a reform and to use better economic principles to take advantage of our water. Thank you. Hello?
Thanks very much, David. I was on mute, so it took me a few minutes to get off that. That was very interesting. Let me go to questions from the audience, and then let's see how to go forward. So if you would like to ask a question, please type it in, and then we can see if Professor Zilberman can answer, or I'll try to read it out for him. So while we are waiting for people to type, it looks like a couple of people are typing. What would you say would be the most likely outcome from the California drought?
Oh, I think can't reform a drought? Several things. First, we start having much better monitoring of groundwater. Secondly, we will have much stricter restriction on water equipment and irrigation and water use, including water use efficiency. Thirdly, I think that we will see increased trading. And then I see both urbanization and water recycling. California is very bad in recycling water. So I really think that you can see much more water recycling. We can gain about 10% of our water back if we recycle them, and it wouldn't be expensive. I think that in the future we can, with smart design, we can also get about 2 or 3 million acre foot from desalinization. So on one hand we will see a better institution, but on the other and more investment.
Yes. So there are two questions, David. I don't know if you can read them on the right-hand side, yes, or if you'd like me to read them for you.
Okay. Without water trading, will the key question, will we have less production without water? And my answer is not, for several reasons. First, if you adopt drip irrigation, you basically may use less water, but you increase water use efficiency. So the amount of water consumed by crop is increasing. Secondly, when the price of food goes up, people develop new technologies that increase water productivity and irrigation effectiveness. It's not only irrigation technologies. You can have new varieties, drought tolerant. And now people start developing these varieties. And one of my areas is biotechnology, and to me, biotechnology has incredible potential to increase water use efficiency and increase productivity. So to some extent, research in agricultural practices can increase water, quality of water, and lead to more harvest water.
The second question that's out there is, how do you get higher energy prices? And I think it's from your, in response to your conclusion slide.
Yes. Okay. So to me, what really happened is that energy, if you look at this century, as the area after the millennium, or especially after 2005, energy prices went up. Now they are down. If people will be concerned about climate change, and I think eventually they will be, then it will result in some sort of carbon taxation or restriction on energy or other type of mechanism. People are concerned also about air pollution, for example, in China, and that results in some restriction on energy. So altogether, energy prices de facto become more expensive. Now, in some areas, for example, in India, people are still subsidized energy for agriculture. Now, when governments have financial crisis or deficit, they cannot subsidize irrigation. So countries like Greece, India, and others, I don't see these subsidies increase. So when the price of energy goes up, people try to think, gosh, how can I reduce energy for water? Moreover, when the price of energy goes up, people start to think about hydroelectric power. So energy and water are quite clearly related, and I expect that in the future, both because of climate change and other reasons, and increased population growth, etc., we will see higher energy prices, and it will have a very interesting effect on water use. Yes.
And there's a question from Adam Shemp also.
Water recycling. Okay, generally speaking, I give you an example of water recycling. For example, in Israel, they use water, they desalinate water, they use it in the city, and then they take the water from the sewage and either recycle it fully to reuse it for consumption or use it in agriculture. In some part of California, they use water that they use in agriculture and they use to grow cotton. in Spain, urban water are used to irrigate citrus. So there are, so basically what happened with the water, you recycle it. In many parts of California, for example, a hotel are using the water from the washing machine to irrigate the golf courses. So there are many ways that you can that you can use water to increase that you can recycle water to increase water productivity. In some areas, there is 80% of the water that are being recycled, especially in urban setting. So I think the potential for recycling is very, very high. Now you said, okay, how can you use save energy when you use pressurized water? Altogether, if you have a drip system with pressurization, it may use less water than a ferro system without pressurization, because the saving in water would reduce energy. Now, secondly, if you have a system that increases water use efficiency, it may be able to pay for the extra energy cost. I agree. Secondly, one of the big challenges is to reduce the pressurization demand for water. Now, pressurization, a lot of time, can increase the efficiency of water. The efficiency of water depends on where you use it, when you use it, how you use it, and a lot of time you may save with a good system of drip and irrigation scheduling 50% of your water, and so the gain in water can be much bigger than the extra cost of pressurization.
Stupid,
the reality is that private farmers that have deep wells tend to move to drip irrigation from a system of ferro because of the saving. Yes?
David, another question from Michelle down there, if you can see that.
Yes. Oh, I mentioned, that's what I mentioned, that this is, this answer this Michelle question. Generally speaking, the cost of fresh air are smaller than the gain from water conservation. And as I said before, with drip and irrigation scheduling, you may save 50% of the water. And that's the reason that people that have private wells in California move to systems like drip. They get higher yield, they use less water, and the extra pressurization actually is saved. Secondly, a lot of time people move from sprinklers that require high pressure to drips that require low pressure, and then they save energy as well.
Okay, there's another question from Naresh now. Farm subsidies.
Subsidies are distorting agricultural production. Now, in California, the only real subsidies that we have are subsidies to corn. And corn production is, and cotton production in California has declined. We have mainly subsidies for rice, in the Midwest we have subsidies for wheat and corn, etc. But when we have a biofuel, the price of this crop went up, so subsidies disappeared. Generally, subsidies are distorting agricultural production. But to be honest with you, subsidies in the United States have declined with biofuel and with the increase in food prices. Now, what we have to some extent are now a crop insurance, and to me, crop insurance in some cases are implicit subsidies. And I myself would like to have less crop insurance. Now, generally speaking, water subsidies, and we add water subsidies, are something that I don't like, because they tend for the people to basically to waste water, not adopt conservation technologies, etc. To some extent, some of the water rights are implied water subsidies. They're even worse than water subsidies, because not only they give you, because They give you too much. They give you too much water, and you pay very little for the water. So the combination of water right and water subsidies are problematic. But realistically, these type of subsidies are declining because government deficits are increasing. So I personally don't like subsidies in agriculture, and I don't like crop insurance, and they distort a lot of stuff. Most of high-value crops that are grown in California are not subsidized. So I think in this regard, California agriculture can survive. The main threat for California agriculture is basically urban development. But I think a high-value crop will survive. In some areas in developing countries, I, for example, would support for a while subsidies for fertilizer. I think that a short period of subsidies for biofuel was useful because productivity of biofuel increased, and now they are not subsidized and they can compete. So the subsidy obviously is a tough topic, yes. And in most cases they are bad.
Okay, looks like that's the set of questions from the audience. Let me ask you one other, which is, in essence, it relates to the drought, but one of the mechanisms of coping with droughts that has evolved is an economic mechanism, that of crop insurance. Would you like to comment a bit about on what crop insurance programs in the United States may have done to stimulate crops in areas which then lead to a hit on the water resources of those areas?
Now, generally speaking, you know, some farmers take insurance, that if you have a high-value crop and you grow orange, you get insurance against hail or drought or stuff like this. And but there are a lot of crop insurance that really deal with drought. And generally, crop insurance that deal with drought a lot of time lead to waste. For example, I know that now in many countries really are concerned about food security. So what they will do, they will pay farmers to grow wheat, and they may grow wheat in the desert 1 out of 4 or 5 years. So if you're connected to the rest of the world and you have good inventory, you probably will be better off not to subsidize production and to let farmers operate without it. In other cases, if the drought occur once every 5 years, then insurance is justified. Insurance can do a lot of work. What I don't like is extremely heavily subsidized insurance. And what happened in the United States, that most of crop insurance in the United States is subsidized. And the reason it is subsidized is that it's legal, according to the WTO, to provide profit insurance. And it's not legal to give farmers direct subsidy. So what the senator in the U.S. said, okay, we reduce direct subsidies, and instead we give crop insurance. But the terms of the insurance are not economically viable, they are subsidies. So a lot of people buy insurance because it makes sense for them. A lot of farmers buy insurance. In many cases in developing countries, crop insurance against drought are very valuable. But sometimes you have excessive insurance that's subsidized, and that's something that I don't like. So you need to do economic analysis of every insurance program and to assess its value. If farmers can pay for insurance without subsidy, it's good insurance. If they cannot pay, it's bad insurance. Now, a lot of time you can have clever information and better understanding of reality, and then you can introduce new crop insurance and improve the welfare of farming. And that's what people are doing now with new GIS data and with new remote sensing. And so you have more opportunities for insurance. But as I said before, sometimes there is a tendency to use insurance as an implicit way to subsidize farmers, and that's not it.
Thanks, David. Looks like Naresh has another question for you that's typed there.
Yes.
On reservoirs in California.
Oh, okay. About few reservoirs. Oh, actually, reservoir, building reservoir is really, really challenging. And maybe with climate change, we need to build new reservoir, because there is one reason to build new reservoir, because with climate change, we'll have more snowmelt. But first of all, we need to know where to build them, because the movement of water will change. Secondly, it may be that even with the snowmelt, there wouldn't be enough water that will justify new reservoir. But my feeling that in the Himalayas, maybe in California and this other region, changes in climate conditions will require new reservoir. Now, another thing is that in many cases, even today, we have floods and we don't capture them. So there may be opportunities to build reservoir near the ocean. We stopped building reservoir near the ocean because of two or three disasters in the 1920s. But now we can have better system and we can build reservoir near the ocean. And we can also build reservoirs that are underground reservoirs. These are the best reservoirs. Reservoirs that we basically use groundwater to store water, so you don't divert land, you don't remove farmers. So there is a potential for new reservoir. And to me, this is a big and important research in water and in geology. A smart reservoir can be an important part of climate-smart agriculture.
Okay, thanks very much. I would love to follow up with you, but I think we have run out of time for the time we reserved for this. So let me thank you and the audience for joining, and we look forward to collaborating with you as we go along. Thanks very much.
Thanks a lot. Thanks for the pleasure. Wonderful.
Oh, and for everyone, these webinars are recorded and they'll be available from the Quasi website. So someone who asked a question about the slides, actually it's not just the slides, everything is available.
Perfect. Great.
Thank you.
Excellent. Bye-bye.